This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
The full audio of this monologue has not been uploaded. To hear the rest of the monologue, please go to razib.substack.com. Again, that's razib.substack.com. Hey everybody, this is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And today I am going to be talking about something a little bit different, a little bit more cultural, perhaps, than I usually discuss during the monologues. And it's about the emergence of European identity, of Western identity, and perhaps the identity of white people, whiteness, that sort of thing. And this is really relevant today because we talk about this all the time. And I, you know, to be entirely candid, I get quite frustrated and angry because most of the people who talk about it are very historically ignorant. I'll give you a concrete example. I'm not going to name names just because... I'm not here to embarrass people, but, you know, about like 5 years ago, more than 5 years ago, actually, I think this was back when, this might have been during the Obama administration, when the Democrats did not hate Russia as much as the Republicans. And so there was a intellectual, a think tanker, he's a pretty prominent person, actually, in the D.C. Greater intellectual sphere. And we were talking about, or he was talking about Western civilization, and he included Russia in there. So this intellectual in D.C. Was talking about Western civilization and Russia, and I responded, Russia's arguably not part of Western civilization. In fact, it probably is not. And they were really confused, and they said, well, you know, they're European. And I'm like, yeah, they're European, but I mean, this is not something that Russians themselves have not thought about. Most of the listeners hopefully will know a little about the, you know, Westernizers versus the Slavophiles and Peter the Great and the people who resisted Peter the Great and the reactions back. And, you know, today in 2022, we obviously think about this a lot because Russia is now in a moment where it's asserting its distinctiveness from the rest of European civilization. What lurked in the background of this discussion I had with this DC think tank intellectual is that Russia is European and Russia is white, therefore it is Western. And he didn't explicitly say that, but it's quite obvious. Russian people, on the whole, not all, but on the whole, they're white and they look just like Northern Europeans. A lot of people in Russia look just like white Americans, like, you know, old stock Northern European white Americans. Genetically, they are very similar to white Americans. Some of them have some Finnic ancestry and Tatar ancestry, but that's the minority. You know, there's a lot of Russians out there, you know, over 100 million. What is it, like 150 million, 160 million, including the near abroad, whatnot. And so, you know, racially, they are like Northern Europeans. In fact, there's not much genetic difference all the way from, say, Brittany and England and Ireland to the Urals, traditionally. Most of the genetic variation in Europe is actually, or more of it, is north-south for various reasons, which some of you know about, and I might allude to that later on in the discussion. But culturally, there's a big difference. And this difference goes back to Eastern Orthodoxy, it goes back to the Tatar yoke, it goes back to the basically long period of separation of Muscovy and what became Russia from the rest of Europe to its west. And it was not always separated like that. Some of you may know that one of the early Rurikid princesses, Anne of Kiev, married into the Capetian royal family in France in the early, high medieval period. So there was a period when Russia was starting to be integrated, when Kiev and Rus was starting to be integrated with other European powers. This was before the really harsh period of the schism between the Eastern Church and the Western Church. This was in the 1000s, the 11th century AD. And then what happened is the Mongols show up, and you know, it's just everything goes to hell in a handbasket, to be entirely frank. Those of you who watched you know, Nevsky and these films, like, know that Russia was basically brutalized and transformed by the Turco-Mongols. Originally, I mean, really the Mongols and the Golden Horde, but they were Turkified, so that's why I say Turco-Mongols. And so that transformed Russia, and out the other end came a very, very different state, society and culture from Europe to its west. So, you know, this assertion that Russia is European and that it's Western bothered me because this history is pretty well known, I thought, but it's not. Now, more recently, there have been other issues relating to Russia where, you know, frankly, there's been Russophobia. And whereas Russophobia before 2016 was culturally illicit, now it is licit because the intelligentsia supports Russophobia entirely candidly. And, you know, I don't need to go into that. That's a separate thing. But now the idea that Russia is fundamentally, qualitatively, civilizationally distinct is quite accepted. It's accepted on ideological grounds. It happens to be true, but the reason people accept it is they want it to be true. And so, you know, we're having this whipsaw about this issue. And, you know, I think I've always been pretty consistent, but other people change based on what they want, and that's frustrating. And now the left is very, very woke, which, you know, the wokening happened in the last 5 years. There's a turn against Western civilization, white supremacy, you know, Eurocentrism. So this brings to the fore what it means to be Western, white, and European. And there's an implicit assumption among many people who do not think deeply. That includes most of our intellectual elite, I think, at least the public intellectual elite, that these are three identical, you know, things. But they're not. They're not. They're just fundamentally not. You know, what is to be Western, what is to be European, and what is to be white are actually different. And when you confuse the two or the three, it just really, really muddles any coherency and any insight. And it deforms our understanding of history and the past, and it probably distorts our understanding of what the future would be. And you can see this actually going back to what I was saying earlier, when this you know, somewhat mildly Russophilic liberal intellectual during the Obama period wanted to assert that Russia was, well, it was a Western nation. This person was wrong. It's complicated. And on the whole, it's not really. And now you see how that matters. I do believe Vladimir Putin made a massive miscalculation invading Ukraine. We have the data, it's come in. But his ideas, his understandings are informed by a sense of Russianness that is very different than what it is to be Western. And Ukraine, which actually helped contribute to that sense in some ways, as a fact, is trying to become Western now, is trying to re-identify and reorient to the West. And I think that there's strong materialist economic reasons for that. Ukraine is, I think, aside from Moldova or Albania, the poorest nation in Europe. It's very populous. So that, you know, they want to be integrated into Europe. I get it, okay? But the fundamental issue is if we had understood how the Russians viewed themselves and thought about themselves, we wouldn't have been as shocked that Putin made the mistake that he did. And so that's why it's important to like understand how things really are and not how they want to be or how we want them to be, you know? So let's start out with genetics because that's the easiest thing to actually talk about. It's the most straightforward thing to talk about. As I said, there actually isn't that much genetic difference between, say, Russians and Northern French and English and Germans. This is a genetic continuum on the North European plain that goes from, you know, Western Russia all the way to the Atlantic. And this is defined by the expansion zone of what some of you will know as accorded where people. As accorded where people moved westward, they transformed into other cultures, for example, the Belbeakers in Western Europe. But fundamentally, they are descended from these men that emerged out of the Pontic steppe about 5,000 years ago, mixed with globular amphora European populations in modern day Eastern Poland, Neolithic farmers, and most of the admixture, about 25 to 30%, was through the maternal lineage. Not all, but a lot of it was through the maternal lineage with these males from the Pontic steppe. And, you know, the recent work actually with ancient DNA has shown this globular amphora Neolithic lineage is very, very prevalent across much of Europe, especially Northern Europe, because there were some places where the synthetic mixed populations did not actually mix much further. So Scandinavia is one case where this is true, where the local funnel-beaker population, the Neolithic population, these are related to globular amphora. They're from the same Anatolian farmer expansion. This funnel-beaker population was totally replaced by the incoming battle axe population. And the battle axe population did have farmer ancestry through globular amphora, but not from funnel-beaker. In Western Europe, it was different. There was more assimilation of the Neolithic substrate in some places. And then once you start to go south, obviously there was more assimilation. So the north and south difference that we are seeing in Europe genetically today, we now know from ancient DNA that this is due to the steppe-like progress of Indo-Europeans and the lesser impact of Indo-European ancestry in Southern Europe, as opposed to Northern Europe. So in Northern Europe, more than half of the population, or more than half of the ancestry can be attributed to Indo-Europeans expanding out of the corded wear complex, whereas in Southern Europe, it's less than half. In some places like Sardinia, it is actually on the low side, perhaps as low as 10%. But in other places like Spain, Northern Italy, and Greece, it's 30 to 40%, high 30s, around 40% maybe. So it's still not trivial. But these genetic components of Neolithic ancestry from Anatolia and the Pontic steppe ancestry are quite distinct. And so if they vary geographically, what you are going to see then is, high differences north to south. In contrast, going from Lithuania all the way to England, there's not that much variation because there wasn't that much admixture of the Neolithic farmer. As some of you know, in Britain, about 90% of the ancestry was replaced. So there was only an absorption of about 10% of Neolithic farmer ancestry, of local Neolithic farmer ancestry, the people that built Stonehenge, the last Neolithic society after 2,000 years of being in Britain. There is an upsurge in Neolithic ancestry later, but we now know that that's mainly from gene flow from mainland, southern parts of Central Europe. There was more indigenous Neolithic survival, and they were absorbed later. In any case, those are details. We are talking about European identity and whiteness and Western civilization. Obviously, let's not even talk about Western civilization. These people are barbarians. When the Romans encountered the Northern Europeans, as most of you know, they're wearing tattoos. The Picts are literally the painted people. They look like white people that have tattoos and all sorts of, body ornamentation and things like that, like from Papua New Guinea or something. They were not that much further developed, culturally. We don't need to talk about European identity or Western civilization, but we can talk about, what is the genetic constituencies, constitution of, people we recognize as white, white European. Well, they didn't really exist 5,000 years ago. We know that for a fact. Now, there are people in Europe, obviously, 5,000 years ago that, would be able to pass as white and probably could have gotten citizenship in the United States as white people. Some of you might know in 1790, naturalization was limited to white, free white people, right? And so you had to decide who was white. So this was done in local courts in the United States often, and there were objections to certain people. So people from India, for example, were usually rejected. Sometimes they were accepted and then it was appealed and their citizenship was taken away. People from the Arab world, like from Syria, were generally allowed begrudgingly to naturalize, right? So Italians, people from Southern Europe, Eastern Europe, Jews, they were all allowed to naturalize. So there is this myth Jews and Italians were not viewed as white. Well, legally they were. And even though the founding Anglo Saxon and to some extent German and Irish that kind of came in between did not view them as white or as totally white. Legally, they accepted them as white and allowed them to naturalize, even though they did so begrudgingly. And, you know, there was some of this attitude towards Catholics as well. There's a whole ideology in the 19th century that basically made it so that the Irish are this fundamentally alien race to the English. And we now know that's all pseudoscience. Genetically, there's not that much of a difference. The Western English in particular are actually quite close to the Irish. Most of the variation is actually driven by Anglo-Saxon migration into East Anglia, Norfolk, that region in the east of England. And so, you know, all of that was pseudoscience driven by religious and cultural bias, right? So in terms of whiteness, this is a big category. So 5,000 years ago, were there white people? Well, you know, if you count Italians as white, if you count Sardinians as white, if you count Syrians as white, yes, there definitely were. Okay. Now, there are some people who have a narrower conception. And so, you know, I mean, these people, they don't necessarily need to be racist. Some of them are. Some of them have like racial, you know, I'll avoid the word racist. I'll just say some of them have racial sentiments and perceptions and feelings. And, you know, they will say people from Spain or Italy or Greece are not really white. Okay. If those people are correct, there were almost no white people, probably really no white people in Europe 5,000 years ago, because the genetic constitution of Northern Europeans did not exist 5,000 years ago. That actually came into being after 5,000 years ago, between 2500 BC and 3000 BC, as the Globular Amphora Neolithic population mixed with the incoming Yamnaya, post-Yamnaya Pontic steppe people. I have posted on my Twitter feed and in some of my posts reconstructions of the Yamnaya. And what do they look like? Well, you know, they look, you know, kind of white, you know, in terms of they could kind of pass, but they're generally swarthier. And we know this because we have the genes. Like, we can look, and pigmentation prediction in Europeans is actually really, really good, especially within the last 10,000 years, because so much of it has been studied for forensics. So the Yamnaya were overwhelmingly dark-haired, and, you know, their complexions would probably range from brunette white to, you know, olive light brown. And they were generally, but not exclusively, dark-eyed. So, you know, I don't know where we would classify them today, but, you know, they definitely did not look like Northern Europeans. What happened, it seems, is the Yamnaya, as they moved north and became courted ware, they mixed the local populations. And some of the local populations had higher fractions of, say, blue eyes, much higher than the Yamnaya, because they had Western European hunter-gatherer ancestry. They were relatively lighter skin because they had the Neolithic farmer ancestry. Mostly darker haired, though. There were some places in Scandinavia where there are pockets of people with lighter hair. But in general, what we think of as the very, very pale Nordic phenotype really was not present in most of Europe, from what I can see in the ancient DNA, 5,000 years ago. By about 2500 BC to 2000 BC, there's large regions where it was. So a lot of the individuals that show up in Britain, what became Britain in 2500 BC with the Belbeakers, they look just like modern British in terms of pigmentation. But if you look closer at the data, it is quite clear to me and to other people that even during the Bronze Age, during the very early Bronze Age and late Copper Age, over 4,000 years ago, Northern Europeans were considerably darker and complected in complexion than they are today. So the easiest way actually to test this is look in the Baltic region, where the frequency of blue eyes is extremely high, above 90% in places like Estonia, and look at the samples. From the ancient period. Now, if they're above 90%, if they're around 90%, 85 to 90% in Estonia, that means since the blue eye genes are segregating OCA2, HERC2 genetic locus, the frequency is actually well above 90, right? Like, so the 0.9 is actually the square of the underlying allele frequency today. And if you look at the ancient DNA, it was considerably lower. It wasn't low, you know, but if you're going from 0.7 to 0.95, that means there's natural selection, and that means the fraction of light eyes and light hair has actually increased noticeably between the Bronze Age and the Iron Age, and actually probably into the medieval period. About, I think it's like 6 years ago now, there's a paper in Science that actually looked at whole genome sequences from England. And if you look at whole genome sequences very deeply and in large numbers, you can detect natural selection up to a very recent period. And it showed that the English, not only were they getting, their skeletons were getting more fragile, that's just a common thing among farmer populations, they were getting lighter in complexion into the medieval period, okay? So, you know, I'm talking about white people. I mean, this is obviously a phenotype, right? It's a trait, it's a set of characteristics. And my point is 5,000 years ago, you know, most of the people in Europe, if they had immigrated to the United States in the 1890s, people like Madison Grant would have said no. Actually, there would have been no immigration because very few people, actually, nobody would be genetically like someone like Madison Grant, and probably almost nobody looked like Madison Grant. So Madison Grant was a prominent public intellectual, a Nordicist that argued for restricted immigrations on racial grounds from people from Southern and Eastern Europe, because he believed that Northwestern Europeans had characteristics and traits that were different and important and should be favored by the American system of immigration and government. So, you know, what happened over the 2,000 years down to, say, the classical antiquity, where we start to have records, is there was natural selection and mixing and synthesis, and the phenotypes that we recognize today were there. Now, as I said, there's places like the Baltic, probably parts of Northern Europe, where, you know, people have continued to get lighter. We know for a fact that other things like lactase persistence, the ability to digest milk as an adult, actually swept to frequency in continental Europe during antiquity, medieval period. It was really late. Like, we know, it's just nobody really understands why. There's papers on it. You can look it up. My only point is it was super late, and nobody really knows what is going on there, right? But a lot of the characteristics we associated with, you know, and like lactase persistence is a characteristic we associate with Europeans, but that's only in the last 2,000 years. It's a little earlier in Britain. Nobody knows why it's a little earlier in Britain, but it's about 1,000 years earlier in Britain, right? So we have these, you know, categories today, but, you know, by the time of Aristotle and Plato, you know, I think mostly you would say, okay, they're white people. Aristotle and the Greeks, they describe people in the Thracians as red-haired, you know, and, you know, the Celtic peoples as having gold hair. So we start to have the range of variation of Europeans that we see now, okay? So we have white people, right? And, you know, in the Middle East, we have, I don't know, off-white brownish people, right? But they didn't actually think of this that way, okay? So as most of you know, the Greeks were very xenophobic. The word, you know, xenophobe is, you know, from Greek, right? And, you know, their major division that they had moral judgments about was between themselves and those who did not speak Greek, barbarians, okay? And there were people who were Greek, who were part of Greek civilization that lived in Western Anatolia on the coastal regions like Miletius, you know, cities like that, and obviously in the Cyclades. And then you had Greeks in the north, like in, you know, towards Ypres, modern-day Albania. So you had a lot of different types of Greeks, but they all spoke Greek. They all went to the Olympic Games. There was a huge debate. An ancestor of Alexander, I think he was an ancestor. I don't think he was a different dynasty. Might have been. From whether Macedonians were allowed to participate in those games. Well, you know, they eventually allowed Macedonians to participate. It seems like they might have bribed them. But in any case, Greek identity was not based on race as we would understand it today. It was based on Greek speech and Greek culture. Now, they were not ignorant of racial differences, and I always like to point out, if you read Herodotus or some of the other Greek ethnographers, they were actually relatively sophisticated. So, you know, they knew people in sub-Saharan Africa, south of Egypt, were quite dark-skinned, and they knew people in Egypt had a lighter brown complexion, and they would describe the two as distinct. They didn't know much about India, but they noted specifically that the people in the north of India had the complexion of Egyptians, so they were lighter brown, whereas the people in the south of India had the complexion of Ethiopians. They were darker brown. But they also noted they were distinct from Ethiopians in that their hair was not woolly. So the Greeks are describing people exactly as they are. They're not they're smart. I mean, you know, anyone who's read Euclid or, you know, tried to read some Aristotle and Plato, I mean, these were smart people. They knew how to classify people, but they did not idealize the classifications in a way that we would understand. So, for example, you know, the movie 300 kind of, and this was in 2007, this was still at the end of the War on Terror period, you know, it was obviously leaning on this idea the Persians were the Orient and the East and the Greeks were the West. Well, I mean, there's something there, but the issue is there was no West. There was just the Greeks. And then there were people in Italy that were trying to copy them. So the Etruscans, their alphabet is based originally on a Greek alphabet that's based obviously on the original Phoenician alphabet that the Greeks used. But, you know, the Greeks are facing these aliens, these alien cultures. But, you know, they looked at everything around them as a sea of barbarism. People that were natural slaves. So, you know, the people in the north that had red hair and very pale skin. And then there were people in the south that were too far south, and they had black skin. And of course, the Greeks, they lived at the perfect temperature, the perfect temperate climate for mental function, for civilization. That was their perception, right? And it wasn't just the Greeks. The Arabs also had these ideas that the people in the north were too far north, and the people in the south were too far south. And, you know, like Baghdad was the perfect latitude where, you know, people were of the, you know, proper middling complexion, whatnot, right? But in terms of like our modern racial categories, you know, there were Ethiopians. They understood that people in India were darker skinned. There were some stylized representations. So the Iranians considered themselves red, which I don't really know if that's, I mean, I don't know if it's like literally true. I think it's like a symbolic thing, right? We sometimes misinterpret these. But the point is, you know, 2,500 years ago, they didn't think in racial terms, although they understood what human taxonomy was because they had eyes. You know, humans have natural folk biology. But when we talk about the Greek canon of the ancient Greeks or the Romans being Eurocentric and white supremacist, we're being anachronistic, right? We're taking our values and putting them back into ancient Greece and Rome. And that's really stupid. So, you know, from the perspective of the Greeks and Romans, they wouldn't understand what we were talking about. I mean, they could figure it out. They're not stupid, but they would have to be educated in, you know, modern taxonomy. So, for example, I would suspect that an ancient Greek during the classical period might be a little confused that, you know, in an American system or an American cultural taxonomy, you know, the Syrian is considered much more exotic to them because they're white than someone from Ultima Thule, like, you know, from Scandinavia, which to Greeks was really exotic, really far away, and they didn't know anything about and was just really strange. Syria, on the other hand, was something Greeks knew about. There were Greeks in Syria. There were Greek speakers, Hellenized, you know, Syrians probably. St. John of Damascus, the last of the church fathers, even though he was from a royal Arab family, Christian Arab family, he spoke Greek and he wrote in Greek. So I think they would not understand the distinctions that we are making. In terms of European, the idea of Europe obviously does come from Greeks, you know, the word itself, but it didn't have the meaning and the relevance that it does today. It would be like saying, it's like telling an American that they're North American. Like, that's literally true. We understand it. But, you know, Mexico, the United States, and Canada, like, do we really classify all those three as North America? No, it's Mexico and, or it's United States and Canada, because Mexico is where Latin America starts. And so we know there's a big cultural difference there. So geography is kind of irrelevant. I think for the classical Greeks and Romans, I think it's fair to say, you know, they didn't make that much of a distinction between the southern Mediterranean, eastern Mediterranean, and northern Mediterranean. They obviously assimilated Gaul and Britannia into their worldview. They introduced villas and You know, if you go to Bath, you'll see all the, you know, Roman ruins, Roman architecture. But, you know, to them, Northern Europe was very, very exotic and strange. And I don't think they would have seen the Europeanness as the key, right? So the Roman Emperor Septimius Severus, you know, famously his mom was colonial descendant. His father was probably Punic or was either Phoenician or maybe like local native Libyan. And, you know, he founded a dynasty that lasted for, you know, about 35 years, I guess. And, you know, his wife was of Syrian origin. And so, I mean, this wasn't a big deal. It wasn't exotic. You know, there are descriptions of Septimius Severus that he was darker, but that wasn't a major issue, you know, because he was Roman. And the key is, you know, he came from, you know, quote, our sea, the Mediterranean. This was a cultural unity. This changed with the rise of Islam. And so really there is a big watershed period in the 7th century when the unity of the Mediterranean was broken, right? And so this is where I get into what David Grass and Plato Nato makes an argument about, that to understand Western civilization, okay, you need to understand the medieval period. You need to understand the conflict between Islam and Christendom, and most particularly the rise of Western Latin Christianity. This is really what the West is. So the Greeks and Romans are super important to the European canon. They're the foundation, but they were a fundamentally different people. And Tom Holland has a new book where he talks about it. You know, some of you that know about the ethics and morality of the Greeks and Romans, is they're very different. The way they treated slaves, you know, we in the United States are starting to have some issues with factory farming. Well, there were slave factories in Sicily where they bred slaves and they, you know, worked them to death. It was really horrible. It was like something that you would see in the American South, but really the Caribbean. So the Greco-Romans were a distinctly slave society, and this is not an issue that's common to the ancient world. Like in India and China, slavery was not as ubiquitous, and in China they actually discouraged slavery because the whole social system was predicated on free peasantry, on free peasants as the foundation of society, right? So the Greco-Romans were very different from us in some ways, and saying that they are white supremacist, or, you know, it's Eurocentric to look at the Aeneid or the Odyssey and the Iliad, it's like, okay, these are not Europeans in a way that we would understand, that these are precursor peoples with a very different self-understanding. Even though, you know, the Greeks and Romans were white, you know, I think we would call them white. They're white people, but they weren't necessarily Western, really. And they, you know, wouldn't have cared that they were European, although geographically they were, and they would understand that. It didn't really mean anything back then, because Islam had not risen and broken the unity of the Mediterranean Sea. So what happened is, with the rise of the Arabs, obviously there's still some trade going on, and some of you might know there's a whole system of books out of the world systems economic history tradition that talks about it's like called Charlemagne and Muhammad, I think, is the book. But it's basically, the whole idea is the rise of Islam broke the trade network in the Mediterranean that still persisted into late antiquity, and it disrupted the trade all across Western Eurasia and transformed a lot of things. For the purposes of this discussion, it transformed a lot of people who had thought that they were of the same kind of cultural continuum into very distinct. So in the modern world, you know, Islam is associated with you know, brown people. That's not really how Arabs actually do think of themselves. I mean, there are obviously black Arabs, especially in places like Sudan and some in Egypt. And 10% of Saudi Arabia's population is actually black in terms of mostly African ancestry. But, you know, they engage in pretty widespread discrimination against them. Arabs generally do actually identify or consider themselves white in their own racial taxonomy. And, you know, genetically, they're much closer to Europeans than they are to people to the south and the east. So that makes sense. But they are obviously of a darker complexion. But it's not like there's a break at the Bosporus. There are Greeks and Italians that are quite dark, and some of it is due to admixture with Eastern Mediterranean, but some of it is just, that's just how they are. You can look at the ancient Greek genotypes and see that that's how they were in the past as well, even before the mass admixture. Or you can see some of the frescoes where some people are depicted with pale hair and blue eyes, and other people are depicted very dark. And, you know, you see in some of the names, with the nicknames like Niger, that some people were on the darker side, right? But that's not that big of a deal. And in the medieval period, the race was not a big deal either, really. It's just that the civilizational difference start to become associated with geographical differences, right? So in Spain, there were a lot of Muslims who are of Iberian origin. And then after the Reconquista, a lot of Christians who are of Muslim origin, right? And so there's some Moorish ancestry in Spain today, but, you know, not as much as you think. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that the Muslim population of Spain was actually converted out of the Christians. And so it just converted back to the religion that they had had, you know, 500, 600 years earlier, you know? So the underlying genetics remain mostly the same, but the culture flipped multiple times. And when you're talking about, you know, conflicts between Muslims and Christians in Spain, there wasn't much physical difference. People could change. There are records of people, you know, becoming spies. So they would change their clothes, change the way they dressed, obviously. And also they spoke each other's language well enough that they could actually pass, right? So they could just culturally be total chameleons. And this is obviously not something that's true. I don't know if, you know, if they were Japanese, right? So, Christianity and Islam was not necessarily racialized at this period, but now we're starting to see very stark geographical differences. So after the Reconquista, and maybe before the Ottomans had really pushed into Europe, you know, you have the situation where Europe is Christian, and the Mediterranean lands to the south and the east are becoming more and more Muslim, to the point where after 1000 AD, there are no more Christians left really in the Maghreb, and there's very few, there are a large minority, but they're not a majority in the Eastern Mediterranean anymore, right? So now we have a situation in the medieval period where some modern conceptions of Westernness and Europeanness start to make sense. So David Gress's idea in From Plato to NATO is that the modern West is an outgrowth of the Greco-Roman heritage combined with Christianity, which obviously originally was a Jewish religion, a Jewish sect, and then was transformed by Hellenism, you know, the contact with the Greeks. And then as it moved west, there were also Latin thinkers like St. Augustine who had their own, you know, overlay on the religion in the West. And this religion became the dominant ethos in Europe and also south and east of the Mediterranean. Originally, Christianity was actually strongest in a place like Anatolia in Turkey, right? Eventually, the Turks took it over, and you know that's not true anymore. But the point is, you know, there's, I think, Hilaire Belloc, an early 20th century Catholic reactionary, said Europe is the faith and the faith is Europe. That would be a ridiculous thing to say in 500 AD. In fact, Philip Jenkins, I think he was at Penn State, he's at Baylor now, he's a historian of religion. And he argues that up until about 800 AD, most of the world's Christians remained in the Middle East. And so in 800 AD, you have to remember that most of Germany was still pagan. Eastern Europe was all pagan. Scandinavia was all pagan. So Christianity in Europe at that period was in the Roman regions of Gaul, some parts of Germany in the west and the south, obviously Italy, Spain, Britain and Ireland, right? So and southern Europe, southeast Europe. And so the point there is the association of Europe with Christianity and Christianity with Europe is very particularly historically contingent. Now, obviously, there were always Christians outside of Europe. Some of you may know that one of Genghis Khan's favorite daughter-in-laws, Sarkakhani, was from a Christian family. So there were Persian Christians that somehow had made it to Mongolia, and there were some in Central Asia at that time in the 1200s. Christians remained a huge minority in places like Egypt, in the Levant. Obviously, Armenians to this day are Christians. So not trying to, deny that there are Christians outside of Europe. You know, a place like Ethiopia, they persisted obviously down to the modern period from late antiquity. But Christianity in Europe became synonymous by the late medieval period. And so we have this emergence of the West as Western Christianity. And this is where I want to go back to what I was talking about with regard to Russia. With the emergence of the Tatars, the Turks, the Turco-Mongols, they really, really push the frontier of Europe to the west. And they did cut off Muscovy from the rest of Europe. Originally, Kiev and Rus was obviously oriented towards the west. It wasn't Kiev, you know, on the Dnieper. And, you know, we know a lot more about the geography in the United States than we probably should at this point because of the war. But, you know, you look at the map, like Kiev is in the south and the west, where Moscow's way to the northeast. Moscow's where it is because it's a really convenient location for a tributary relationship with the Tatar capital of Sarai, which was on the Volga. And the princes, the Danilovich lineage, I think, in of Rurikids in Moscow was actually not a very senior lineage. They shouldn't have become, you know, the primary princes of the Russians, but eventually became the Tsars. But they were patronized by the Tatars because of their location. They did even intermarry a little bit with the Tatars, and the Tatars intermarried with them. I'm not saying that they're Tatar. Like, that's, again, a Western slur, kind of. But they were transformed. They were transformed in a lot of ways culturally, and I don't think we can deny that. So in the late medieval period, we have this association of Christianity with Europe, but then we also have a separation between Western and Eastern Europe. And this separation is strongly associated with religion and associated with, the language that is used in the liturgy. So in the West, that's Latin. In the East, local languages. I mean, Greek is used a lot, actually, even in non-Greek areas. But a lot of times, like, they switch to the local vernacular. So Old Church Slavonic, I think, in much of Eastern Europe. That's Orthodox. It was used for a long time, right? My point here is it doesn't make any sense to talk really about Western people at all 2,000 years ago. It's really weird and anachronistic and ahistorical to talk about Eurocentrism. There were so many Greek thinkers that were in Alexandria. Are they European thinkers or are they African thinkers? So what does that even mean? I mean, it's just stupid, right? It's stupid. So take a step back and realize how anti-intellectual it really is, and think about it. Now, obviously, I'm not saying that people need to, actually to other people, but just think about it and maybe privately bring it up in certain, I will not privately bring it up. I'll publicly bring it up. Not everyone's not like that, right? My point is, though, is like we're distorting our understanding of the past. People are entirely confused about what's going on because, you know, what the Chinese call rectification of the names, where terms align to reality, we are distorting reality. We are distorting reality by just mangling the terms. So by about 1400, though, you do have an emergence of, Europeanness and proto-Westernness, Christendom, right, in Western Europe. It's quite distinct. When the English under Queen Elizabeth made recontact with Russia, through Archangel, the port in the north on the White Sea, the Russians were super excited. But it was just really exotic. The Russians were exotic at this point. They had been transformed by their isolation from Western Europe, and the English seemed really strange and foreign. Even though the Russian royal family, at that time they were still like classical Rurikids, they're not Romanovs yet, were actually cosmopolitan. So Ivan the Great did not have that much what we would call great Russian ancestry. He was like, or Ivan the Terrible, Ivan Grozny. He was, he had like Swedish and Tatar and other random things. I think some German. They were very cosmopolitan, but they were an imperial people rooted in an Orthodox Christian religion that made them very different. And their idea of autocracy and their attitude towards liberty were very different than what was evolving in Western Europe. And within Western Europe, there were differences. So, in the Rhineland, in the late medieval period, the more autocratic, oppressive forms of serfdom disappeared, and you had farmers that started engaging in industry and gains of productivity. And actually, German farmers from the Rhineland were recruited to Prussia in eastern Germany to increase productivity by landlords. But there was, the Prussian area, what is today modern GD, Western Poland and the modern Eastern Germany, right? The former East Germany were Prussia. And these areas were very backward and very distinct from Western Germany, which kind of set more of the tone for what we would consider German culture today, really. The Prussians, they set the tone because, they were a garrison state, and Prussian discipline and coldness and efficiency and all those things. So that's far later. My only point is a lot of the stereotypes and perceptions are starting to crystallize by 500 years ago, and we're starting to see the origins and the lineaments of the modern world now. And so to rewind, because I've been talking for a while, so by the end of the Bronze Age, kind of mostly Europeans genetically look like what you see today. There's still a little work to be done in Northern Europe in particular, getting people, to be as pale as modern day people in Finland or whatever. But, in general, I think people recognize already by the end of the Bronze Age what's going on. Thank you for listening. To hear the rest of the monologue, please go to razib.substack.com and subscribe.
This podcast for kids. This is my favorite part.